Thank you very much. I don't think I will be using the word energy in my talk because it mainly focuses again, so we take the thread again from the reason we are motivated about the energy work, which is the climate change and how this is manifested. Now starting to zooming a bit on our region more. First, I will give you a very brief update on the current, let's say, status of global warming, as it has been monitored regularly by temperature measurements from thousands of ground-based stations around the globe. So you are all probably almost all aware about the fact that the recent years we are breaking warming records. And now we're talking about the average temperature over the surface of the Earth, near the surface of the Earth. The 2016 was the warmest year on record. And when I say record, I mean of the ground-based stations, which roughly begin of the middle of the 19th century. 2015 and 2017 were also very warm years, one of the warmest years. And now, and I'm going to continue next, 2018 is going to be another very warm year. And of course, the reason is the increasing levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, mainly driven by human activities. And again, I'm giving you an update of the current status of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere as represented, and it is a good representation of the global, let's say, the amount of carbon dioxide from the oldest record we have, in Mauna Loa in Hawaii. And this is a measurement up to a few days ago. So a few years ago, we broke the 400 parts per million. And you see, this is a very steady increase of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. That also goes together with the increase in temperature, especially the recent decades. So going back to the global warming update, this is a time series now of the temperature averaged over the whole surface of the Earth, again, by the same ground stations I showed you at the beginning. And it's interesting because you can see, of course, the rapid warming of the last decades at the end of the 20th century. 2016, you can see, was the warmest. And 2017, one of the warmest. It seems that 2018 will not be as warm as the previous 2-3 years, but still, it will be at least 0.6 degrees higher than the reference period that this graph is using to measure the change, which is actually the period 1961-1990. I also plotted here another period, 1851-1880, which we can use it as a baseline for the pre-industrial period. I would like to do this because also from the previous talks and also for the Paris Agreement, let's say, goals, it's the 1.5 or 2 degrees relative to the pre-industrial. So I have to make this kind of a correction or shift in the graph that you will see next in order to express the same changes from year to year compared now to the pre-industrial. So if the baseline now is this very early period, obviously the 1969-90, it's a bit warmer. And of course, you can see that the record we have in 2016 was more than 1.1 degrees. So again, as the previous keynote speakers mentioned, we are already in the plus 1 degree warming. And the last of this global warming update graphs, this is the update now if we take the same measurements but plot them averaged by decade. So you can see now a bit better and more clearer the long-term but continuous warmer conditions that the planet is experiencing throughout actually the 20th century. Of course, the rapid increase of the last 3-4 decades. And this is our decade with data, of course, up to 2017, because we need to complete the 2018 record, which also, again, is compared with the pre-industrial. So we are very near the 1 degree warming compared to pre-industrial. Now, starting to go into more regional or local levels, in the Cyprus Institute, in collaboration with the Department of Meteorology, the government's competent authority for measuring and forecasting the weather, we are using its long-term records in order to kind of to watch how climate is evolving over Cyprus. So this is an example from a station nearby in Athalassa. Actually, we are in Athalassa area here. And I'm trying to replicate the same, let's say, method from the previous global warming graph. So this is the representative of the Cyprus warming. So if you can see, of course, the record is not so long. It's one of the versions of this record. So we have only 36 years from the 1980s. So you can see all the years after around 1999 were warmer than the 20th century average. I use also a different baseline because of the data availability we have. And 2010 and until now was the warmest year in Cyprus, where actually the temperature was a bit less than 2 degrees compared to the 20th century. And here with the orange, I have plotted how the temperature anomaly of this year might be, of course, with data until the summer. So it seems that if all the rest of the months from September onwards are near the climatic average, it seems that 2018 will be actually the warmest year on this record for this location for Cyprus. And have a look actually of the magnitude. So we're talking about more than 2 degrees warming for our region and our island. Now I'm moving to the issue of how we can use climate models in order to, because so far I've talked to changes that we can record until now, past and current changes. With the use of climate modeling, and we have a dedicated research group here in the Cyprus Institute dealing with atmospheric and climate change with observations, but also with models. We're going to see how we can project this global, let's say, projections for the region. I'm just reminding here because this has been said more or less before, and it's widely known from the IPCC reports, the emission scenarios that we are using in order to drive our climate models and see the future evolution of temperature and other climate variables. Because in the next slides, you will be seeing different projections of temperature for different emission scenarios. I'm just plotting here from the KNMI graph, which basically summarizes the different scenarios. So the blue line here, now this graph, it shows a scenario in terms of CO2 equivalent concentration. So the blue line is the RCP 8.5, and the 8.5, this number next to the RCP, which means relative concentration pathway, refers to the radiative forcing, the intensification of the greenhouse effect that these greenhouse gases bring. So this is the business as usual scenario, the blue line. The black line is the stabilization scenario, it's called 6.0. And the red line is the RCP 4.5, which actually seeks to act quicker on reducing the emissions. And it's more or less, one would say, following, or it's similar to the Paris target. And lastly, it's the all-out effort to limit the global warming below 2 degrees. So this is the best, our best case scenario, we can say. I want to mention here that all these scenarios are illustrative and plausible, but they don't carry with them any probabilities. So we don't know which, of course, going to happen, or is what more probable to happen. Now, these scenarios of carbon dioxide projections can be translated through the climate models into temperature projections. You have seen this before. So we can see, for example, the effect of the business as usual scenario. I apologize for the different color now of this scenario. So this is the business as usual scenario, which by the end of the century predicts almost 5 degrees global warming. Most of the other scenarios, including 2, 6, 4.5 and 6 degrees, by the middle of the century, reach 2 degrees as well. And in the middle, I have the A1B scenario, which was the previous generation of IPCC scenarios that sometimes are still being used and analyzed. So if we put together all these scenarios in a different climate models, and there are at least 2 dozens of climate model groups around the globe that are running, are driven by these emission scenarios, you can have the different scenarios of global warming throughout the 21st century. By the different scenarios, you can see here the different number of models that they have used these scenarios. Now, the interesting thing here is that we also plot the observations, which is the black thick line, because the model are also, the simulations begin from the 1950s or earlier in order to test the models. So the gray, let's say, the gray lines here are all the model simulations, and the black line is the observations up to 2005. Which actually the models used as the historical period. Now, the real test for the models is the period after 2005, where they are driven kind of freely only by the emission scenarios. And we can see also at the same time how the actual observed temperatures have been evolving around the globe. So, of course, you can see that what has happened since 2005 is within the range of the different model scenarios. One would say that after 2000, maybe we're a bit on the lower side, but for example, the 2015-2016 warming has brought back the observations to the middle of the range of the models. So it's interesting to follow this from year to year. So barring any big volcanic eruption that it will disrupt and it will cool for a while the climate, it means we are heading by the middle of the century towards the 1.5 and 2 degree world. Now I'm zooming to our region with a method of dynamical downscaling by using regional climate models. We are able, that are driven by the fields of the global model, we are able to simulate these IPCC projections over a limited area of the globe. For example, here Europe. What we achieve here is to a higher spatial resolution of the meteorology and also of the available climate information. And this makes the regional climate models very suitable for impact and adaptation studies, because they bring us all these projections you saw at the global average scale or to the regional level, which is useful for national, let's say, assessments. And there is a global effort, global initiative, is the CORDEX, which is the regional climate downscaling experiment coordinated by the WCRP and WMO, where different groups, they try to zoom or downscale the IPCC projections over different areas of the world, mainly the continents. Of course, for our region, there are several continents, domains in that were out of interest. Cyprus Institute is a contact point that is helping coordinate the activities in the domain of the Middle East and Northern Africa part of the CORDEX, the MENA CORDEX. And also, of course, very relevant to us is the MED CORDEX, the domain and the simulations that are focused over the Mediterranean. And so here again is a zooming over our region. Of course, the MENA CORDEX domain is a vast domain that takes into account not only South Europe and Mediterranean, but also really the whole of Northern Africa and the Middle East. And this, you can see the overlap of the MED CORDEX, and I will show you next why, I will tell you next why I'm showing you this overlap. It's very useful because Mediterranean then can be covered by more than one CORDEX domain, so we can have more simulations to analyze. Before I go to the original simulation, I just show here a rather recent, let's say, publication from our group that highlighted the increase in heat extremes over the MENA region by analyzing data from the global climate models, but focusing again on the MENA region. And one of the things I just want to highlight here, this is the projections of the temperature. So this is change in temperature by mid-century, according to the RCP 4.5 scenario, which is similar, let's say, it's a less intense scenario, supposedly similar to achieve the Paris goals, which is limit to 1.5 or 2 degrees. But if you can see here from the color scale, it's dominated by lighter or dark red, which is all more than 2 degrees. So this is exactly what has been also discussed before in the previous session, that despite the we should not be looking only at the global average changes, but looking at the regional changes. So our region, and especially the Northern Africa as parts of the Middle East, will be more strongly warmed in different seasons like the summer, and more than the targets that this scenario is supposed to achieve on a global scale. And the last point we want to make here and highlight is that this area of the world is already very warm. In the summer, many locations in these areas exceed 50 degrees, and now we're talking about the summer average change. So imagine if we move more than this 2 or 3 degrees, not very late in the time, this is just by the middle century, it means that the temperatures in this region will become unbearable. So there is a question now of human survival in some areas of that region, if this supposedly mild scenario takes place. We also downscale some of these global projections with a WRF model for the MENA region, and this is a summary of the projected changes of temperature over the MENA region under two different scenarios. On the left, the 4.5 scenario, and on the right, the 8.5 scenario, the business as usual scenario, by the middle of the century, the top maps, and by the end of the century, the lower maps. So it's very clear that, for example, by the end of the century, with the business as usual scenario, we are dealing with temperature increases of more than 6 or even 7 degrees in several parts of this domain, which is again raises this big alarm about the human, let's say, condition and the human health in the region. Based on these results, and by trying to scale them according to the pre-industrial conditions, I'm plotting now for an average over the Mediterranean region how the temperatures will evolve in the 20th century in different seasons, and on the annual average, which is the dotted line, according to the RCP 4.5 scenario from our simulations. So this is it just puts in a time context, when are we going to enter this 1.5 world or conditions. So according to our model simulations, especially in the summer, which is the red line, we are already in the 1.5 world. And of course, we saw it also from the observations I showed you from Nicosia and Cyprus, where we experience 1.5 degree warming. But if we only take the annual average of temperatures, we see that around 2030, according to our downscaling simulation and to 4.5 scenario, we are going to enter the 1.5 world. So this connects also to the target and the urgency before 2030 to reduce the emissions. My colleague, George Zitis, has taken simulations from all available Cortex domains that overlap over the Mediterranean in order to produce a multi-model, multi-scenario, let's say, super ensemble of projections for the Mediterranean. And I'm just showing you here the projections from the south and eastern part of the Mediterranean. And this is the temperature change according to the three scenarios. And where you can see from the 20th century until the end of the 21st century, so you can see with the business as usual scenario, the warming at the end of the century will be 5 degrees. And of course, here we can see that the scenario does matter, but it's more or less is becoming more important after around the middle of the century. And here on the bottom, this is the rainfall, how rainfall is going to change in the future. So according, the rainfall is very variable. So you can see the interannual variability from the observations, because the black line are the observed values, the years. But still, we can see a diminishing trend of rainfall, especially towards the end of the century, and especially under the high emission scenario, the red scenario, the RCP 8.5. And again, if we want to zoom more, with a different study that my colleague Georgitis is concluding now, we take projections from regional climate models of even higher spatial resolution of 12 kilometers or 0.1 degrees. So from the Eurocortex domain, we have actually analyzed the projections of several models for all available scenarios for Cyprus, averaged over the area of Cyprus. Here in the insert, again, you can see the carbon dioxide equivalent of these scenarios, the business as usual, the 4.5 and the 2.6, let's say the best case scenario. And you can see that in all scenarios, in all, let's say, high or medium emission scenarios, we have more than 2 degrees or more than 4 degrees change at the end of the century for Cyprus. And I'm going to conclude, these high resolution results gives us a precision of the climate information at the scale of the 12 kilometers. So now we can have more, let's say, refined climate projection picture over a small country or an island like Cyprus. And so here we see, this is the baseline, let's say, is a control period around the end of the 20th century. So this is how temperature is distributed in Cyprus, averaged for the whole year. In the next, I'm going to show you how this temperature is going to change by the end of the century according to the three scenarios. So this is the best case scenario that we see, that even in the best case scenario, by the end of the century, we will still have more than half a degree further warming. In the intermediate scenario, the kind of Paris Agreement goal scenario, by the end of the century, Cyprus will be more than 1.5 degrees, almost 2 degrees warming by the end of the century. And finally, by the business as usual scenario, you can see now the scale of the color scale is changes, that Cyprus is going to experience an island-wide warming or more than 3.5 or even 4 degrees, especially in the central parts of the area. So this kind now of high-resolution information is very useful for vulnerability, climate change vulnerability and adaptation studies. And now if we start looking also at the other variables of these meteorological models, maybe we can start looking at possible, let's say, collaboration with the energy, actually, with the energy people, so I didn't avoid it at the end, in how, for example, conditions, sunshine conditions will change in the future, because our model can say that for, let's say, long-term assessments, of course, apart from the short-term energy forecasting. And I'm finishing about, apart from the projections are the impacts, so we are also trying to translate our results into impacts. In a recent study with Odros Zachariadis, we estimated the heating and cooling degree days, basically the energy demand for Nicosia, according to some of our previous projections over Cyprus. So overall, despite the lessening of the warming demand in the winter, overall, because of the also cooling demand in the summer, there will be a net energy demand for Cyprus, about 6% rise every year. That this can be translated in a few hundreds of million euros for the national, let's say, economy. And last, another example here is when we can translate these projections into production in agriculture. This is the wheat yield with my colleague Katiana Konstantinidou, where this is the background, let's say, yield of wheat in the Eastern Mediterranean, and this how will zone change in the future. This color actually is in a non-suitable areas, and you can see that the non-suitable areas thermally are increasing in the future. Maybe there will be also a few gains and benefits in some areas that will get warmer. So this is one way also to translate our climate projections. And I will stop here and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Panos. So was that 10-kilometer resolution?
The last maps of Cyprus?
Yeah.
Yeah, the 12, around 12 kilometers. Yeah.
Okay, it's great to see the models getting to that level of resolution because you can learn so much more. Any questions for Panos? Yes.
Yes.
Mike's coming.
See if you can give us some more information, because you touched on this. What would be the change for this 4-degree scenario about, say, beam radiation, DNI? What do the models expect it to be?
I don't know the answer now. We need to look at the literature. From some of our earlier simulations, I had a look, for example, in the radiation, and I found not a lot of change overall over Cyprus. I think the confidence in these results is going to be a bit less than the confidence we have for the temperature, because as it was already mentioned, the radiation is affected, for example, by cloudiness. And clouds and humidity is one of the most difficult parameters to model in the climate models. I don't have a value now, so I'm not able to tell you how this will change.
Thank you.
Panos, I have seen a study for Crete, which shows that the major part of the deficit, the water deficit in Crete, will be due to the increase of evaporation, and the precipitation decrease it contribute to maybe less than 20%. Do you think that it will be the same for Cyprus?
I can speculate on that, but we need to actually break down the model output and verify that. But it sounds plausible, yeah.
Panos, one thing I was trying to think about why this seems to be amplification here compared to the global average. And I guess what I'm wondering is, because a lot of this region is very dry, there's a lot of night sky radiation that cools it down. And I'm wondering if the additional greenhouse gases are raising nighttime temperatures and if that is a major factor.
Of course, yeah, especially in Northern Africa. But there is now you mention it, and I have not shown it, although we have studied it, there is another actually feedback effect on the, let's say, South Europe and Eastern Mediterranean, which is soil moisture atmosphere feedback. So when you have less rainfall, you have less soil moisture, so less evaporative cooling. So let's say the summer months, they tend to be affected by this. So it's kind of amplifying the warming because of the less rainfall.
So there's less natural evaporative cooling. I mean, that's a major. Okay, very interesting. I think we have time for one more question, if anybody has a question. Yes.
I wonder the 0 point. How did you set it?
Is it? I think. Where did you find it?
You are referring about the global
the
average
point that the previous presentation pictures.
I didn't mention exactly. So I took the evolution of the global average temperature change, which has a reference of 1961-1990. So I assume.
What about before
or less
that?
This is,
what about before that? Is it the right place or a little over or below?
Okay, this is just by looking at the graph. So it's like a handmade ruler measurement. So depends. These are the actual graphs, and they show how temperature changes over the years compared to the 1961-1990 average, which is this line here. So it's like with a manually or with my eye, I say that this is a zero.
Yeah. Okay.
This is a reference. Yeah.
Thank you.